Hope everyone is doing well this morning. My name is Gene Aiken. I'm the pastor here at Memorial. We are delighted that you have joined us here this morning. If you open your bulletin, we'll go over the announcements with you. The United Methodist Women are having a dinner on Tuesday, October 8th at 6 p.m. in the Social Hall. If you would like to come, the cost is $10, and you can sign up by calling the church office or registering in the pew pad as it comes around. Speaker is Ruth McWhite, who's the director of women's ministries at North Greenville, and Brett Hovis is preparing the meal, so it will be a wonderful and delightful meal. Supper at 6 is Wednesday, October 9th, and Brett Hovis is cooking for us 2 days in a row. So if you get to go to both, you are going to be filled with good food. But we invite you to come. You can also register with the pew pad or calling the church office for that as well. And Don Chapke is going to do a concert for us that evening after supper. So we're excited and look forward to that. There's a men's adult Bible study starting on Sunday, October 13th. It's an 8-week series. It will meet, the bulletin says 6 to 7, but it will be 5 to 6 during that normal Bible study time and during the children's events. If you're interested, contact John Tamako, who's leading it, or you can call Leslie in the office. Trunk or Treat is Sunday, October 20th at 5 in the FLC. It will be a great time for our children to come together and celebrate and enjoy everything together. Mission Kids continues tonight from 5 to 6 p.m. upstairs in the FLC. As part of Mission Kids, they are collecting Band-Aids. They're collecting Band-Aids for the children at the Children's Hospital in downtown Greenville. Now, we don't want the plain, boring, brown Band-Aids that no kid ever wants. They want colorful Band-Aids, unicorns if you have girls, or superheroes if you have boys, or anything in between. If you want to bring boxes, you can bring them. There'll be places for you to collect, for areas for you to give those Band-Aids, and they're collecting those. Youth are going to serve with the children on October 6th. There's going to be a special mission project from 5 to 6, so we invite the youth to join in on that as well. And the ministry highlight for this week, you can see the Mission Kids there learning about salt and light from last week. So we are excited about all that is going on. Also, the Christmas choir. Join us starting October 2nd from 7 to 8:30 in the choir room for food, fun, music, and festive music. All voices are welcome. Really, all voices?
Not yours.
Not mine? Yeah, no. Probably a good idea. She's learning, I'm telling you. You don't want mine?
I do want yours,
yeah. No, actually, you don't. So we are also thankful for the handbells this morning, for the gift of music that they are sharing with us this morning, for the beautiful music they have already given, and for that which they will continue to give throughout this service. We are grateful. We are thankful for all that God has given to us, for the opportunity to come and to worship this morning. Let us stand and sing together our opening hymn, hymn number 158, Come Christians, Join to Sing.
Thank you.
invite you to join me now as we affirm what it is we believe with the words of the Apostles' Creed, as found on page 881 in your hymnals. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From this you shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Our first scripture lesson this morning is found on page 930 in your pew Bible, and it is the 91st Psalm. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in whom I trust. Surely He will save you from the fowler's snare and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with His wings. He will cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness will be your shield and rampart. You will not fear the terror of night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that stalks in the darkness, nor the plague that destroys at midday. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. You will only observe with your eyes and see the punishment of the wicked. If you make the Most High your dwelling, even the Lord, who is my refuge, then no harm will befall you, no disaster will come near your tent, for he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. You will tread upon the lamb and the cobra. You will trample the great lion and the serpent. Because he loves me, says the Lord, I will rescue him. I will protect him, for he will acknowledge my name. He will call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
I invite you to join me now in prayer together. God, I give you thanks for a moment to listen. May we be a people who learn to listen more than we speak. May we be a people who learn to give thanks for all that we have. For Lord, all the gifts that we have are from you. Our very life, the air we breathe, is from you. Lord, you have called us to be stewards of all that we have. God, help us to do that more and more each day. Lord, some of us come this morning hurting for ourselves or for family or friends. Lord, we pray your healing. Some of us come with lives that are so busy and so distracting and filled with chaos, Lord, that we pray for your peace. Some of us come just seeking to remember that you walk with us every step of the way. God, may we find all this in you, and may we seek all this in you as we pray the prayer you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now for our offering. We invite you, if you feel led, to place your offering in the offering plate as it comes around, or there are instructions in the bulletin for how to give electronically. We know that not everyone is ready to give, but when you are, we will gratefully receive. Be seated. Before I have the scripture reading for this morning, I want to make a confession. We are starting our series of stewardship sermons. Never in my life have I heard anyone in a congregation say, "You know what, preacher? I really wish you'd preach about stewardship and money today." I've never heard anybody say that. And you know what? I've never heard a preacher go, "You know what? I think I'd really like to preach on money today. People love it when I do that." Well, be rest assured, I don't think stewardship's about money. I mean, it is. There's that part of it. But I think stewardship is much, much bigger than that. And so for the next 4 weeks, today I'm going to talk about what I think a steward is. What in the world does stewardship mean? And then the next 3 weeks, I'm going to talk about what Wesley used when he said, "Gain all you can," which I think most of us are in favor of. "Save all you can," which, again, I think most of us are in favor of. And then "Give all you can," which hopefully by that time we'll all be in favor of. But I want to spend some time today talking about what stewardship is, because I think being a steward is much bigger than our general idea and perspective. So our scripture reading today comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 1 through 14. "So a person should not think about us this way, as servants of Christ and managing..." So a person should think about us this way, "as servants of Christ and managers of God's secrets. In this kind of situation, what is expected of a manager is that they prove to be faithful. I could care less if I'm judged by you or by any human court. I don't even judge myself. I'm not aware of anything against me. But that doesn't make me innocent, because the Lord is the one who judges me. So don't judge anything before the right time. Wait until the Lord comes. He will bring things that are hidden in the dark to light, and he will make people's motivations public. Then there will be recognition for each person from God. Brothers and sisters, I've applied these things to myself and Apollos for your benefit. I've done this so that you can learn what it means not to go beyond what has been written, and so none of you will become arrogant by supporting one of us against the other. Who says that you are better than anyone else? What do you have that you didn't receive? And if you received it, then why are you bragging as if you didn't receive it? You've been filled already. You've become rich already. You rule like kings without us. I wish you did rule so that we could be kings with you. I suppose that God has shown that we apostles are the end of the line. We are like prisoners sentenced to death because we have become a spectacle to the world, both to angels and to humans. We are fools for Christ, but you are wise through Christ. We are weak, but you are strong. We are honored, but we are dishonored. Up to this very moment, we are hungry, thirsty, wearing rags, abused and homeless. We work hard with our own hands. When we are insulted, we respond with a blessing. When we are harassed, we put up with it. When our reputation is attacked, we are encouraged. We have become the scum of the earth, the waste that runs off everything up to the present time. I'm not writing these things to make you ashamed, but to warn you, since you are my loved children. The word of God for the people of God. So as I began to think about what does it mean to be a steward, I began to think about one thing kept popping in my head. I love the trilogy, The Lord of the Rings. Tolkien did a great job with that. And I began to think, if you've ever seen those movies, of the Steward of Gondor. There's a guy who sat on the throne of a kingdom called Gondor, and he was the steward. He thought he was the king. His chair was actually not even where the king sat. He had to sit lower and to the right of where the king sat. He wasn't the king, but he ruled as if he was. All he cared about was the power he had. He cared nothing for the place that he ruled. He cared nothing for anything other than himself and his power. And within that, he almost destroyed everything because he thought it was all about him, what he wanted. What he failed to realize is what God says. God says, everything you have is a gift. Everything you have is a gift. The life that you have is a gift. Think about it. When you were born, they take you, they clean you up, they wrap you up, they hand you to your parent. They do not give your parent an instruction manual of what to do with you. They just hand you and say, congratulations. You hope that that parent understands what it means to change a diaper, to feed you, to take care of you, to help heal you when you are sick. You are totally and utterly dependent on that parent when you are born. And then you go through life, you get sick. You break bones. You fall and hurt yourself. Your heart gets crushed. You are fragile. And then usually at the end of life, you're back to having someone take care of you again. It's amazing, our life cycle. We are fragile. But everything we have, even life itself, the air we breathe, is a gift from God. But not only is our life a gift from God, but all that is around us, creation, is a gift from God. Our fourth and fifth graders are learning about that. They were learning about creation. And their teacher said, what do you want to do about this? And they said, we want to collect stuff for the puppy dogs. I cannot wait for y'all to see the amount of stuff that was collected. And they did it all themselves. They led the charge. They used you to help them collect. But right now they're delivering to the Greenville Humane Society a massive amount of food and toys and bowls because they understand that even the dogs at the Humane Society are part of God's gift to us. Creation is a gift. Everything that we have is a gift. Not only creation, but all of our money, abilities, time, relationships, education, life, everything is a gift. Now listen, you and I are endowed with certain gifts. I mean, we kind of come with some skill sets. And we can develop those skill sets. Now, some of us may want to develop skill sets that God doesn't necessarily give us to start to develop anyway. I would love to be an amazing singer. That's not happening. If I was on American Idol, I'd be the one they did the background of and then made fun of as I began to sing. If I came on The Voice, they cut me off after 30 seconds and just kicked me out without the judges even deciding whether or not they need to turn around. I'm trying to learn to run, to get in shape. I'm not going to be a marathon runner. God did not endow me with that gift. Your boy here is not going to run in the sprints anytime soon. I am not fast. But I do have gifts. I would like to develop certain gifts that don't necessarily happen for me. But God calls me to develop the gifts that I do have. To spend time on the things that God has already given me a little bit of, to make them better. You and I each have gifts. It's up to us as to how we develop them. God reminds us. I love this hymn. I sing the almighty power of God. Let me quote you this hymn. I sing the almighty power of God that made the mountains rise, that spread the flowing seas abroad and built the lofty skies. I sing the wisdom that ordained the sun to rule the day. The moon shines full at God's command and all the stars obey. I sing the goodness of the Lord who filled the earth with food, who formed the creatures through the word and then pronounced them good. Lord, how thy wonders are displayed wherever my eyes turn. If I surveyed the ground I tread or gaze upon the sky, there's not a plant or flower below but makes thy glories known and clouds arise. and tempests blow by order from thy throne. While all that borrows life from thee is ever in thy care. And whatever that we can be, thou God, are present there. It reminds us that God gives us everything, but that last line also reminds us that God is present here in this world today. So not only has God given us everything, but God says, you know what? I've given you everything, and I'm still going to be part of your lives. How often do we pray to God for things? If we didn't believe that God was present in our lives, then why do we pray? If we don't believe that God is present in our lives, then why do people say so many times, I feel the prayers and the peace that brings me when people are praying for me? God is present here and amongst us. So if God has given us everything and God says, I have not abandoned you, I am with you, then what does it mean for us to be a steward? Douglas Meeks says that steward comes from an old Anglo-Saxon word, stiward, which means the keeper of the pigsty. So as a steward, we are the keepers of the pigsty. Can you imagine if I got up here and preached a sermon about keeping the pigsty? But what does that mean for us? It means that a steward is someone whose domain is derived from another and expressed in feeding, protecting, caring for, and preserving that which is entrusted to him or her by the owner of the household. For us to be stewards, it means that you and I are entrusted with what God has given us. 1 Peter 4:10 says, like good stewards of the manifold grace of God, serve one another with whatever gift each of you have received. Our scripture reading today says that we are stewards of God's mysteries to be found trustworthy. What are those mysteries? Colossians tells us that the mysteries are Christ in you, the hope of glory. So you are the steward of all of these things. Wesley says that God has entrusted us our soul, our immortal spirit, made in the image of God, together with all the power and faculties thereof, understanding, imagination, memory, will, and train of affections, love and hatred, joy and sorrow, respecting both good and evil, desires and aversion, hope and fear. We are stewards of all of this. We are to be the ones who take care of all of these things. They're not ours. We have been given them. You and I cannot pull ourselves up by our bootstraps. Everything we have has been a gift. So stewardship is about more than money and budgets. It's about more than filling out pledge cards. Stewardship is who God is. God is the good giver of all things. Stewardship is about how God is present in the world, how God continues to work through me and you. And stewardship is what God expects of us. John Wesley said, we are not at liberty to use what God has lodged in our hands as we please, but as God pleases, who alone is the possessor of heaven and earth, and the Lord of every creature. We have no right to dispose of anything we have, but according to his will, seeing we are not proprietors of any of these things. You and I have been given these things, and God says, it is not yours to throw away. I have given you these things so that you can use them, so that you can be a steward of the things that I have given you, whether it's money or gifts or talents or witness or service or time, whatever it is, God has given it to you to be a good steward of. Now, sometimes we may not feel like what we have is enough. I love teaching Bible study because not only am I teaching, but I learn as I'm teaching. The other night, the first night I was teaching Bible study here, we were gathered around and we began discussing the sermon that Jesus delivered to the 5,000 and the subsequent feeding of the 5,000. Now, I've heard this story of the feeding of the 5,000 100 times. It's familiar. But I saw it in a new light for the first time as I was teaching. I didn't even plan to talk about it. But it came to me in a new teaching. To catch you up, if you don't remember, Jesus is standing there preaching to everyone. The disciples go to him and say, "Jesus, by the way, it's getting close to dinner time. Nowhere around here to get food. You need to send everybody home." And Jesus says, "Nah, you guys feed them." I can imagine the disciples standing there going, "We feed them? We don't have any food. There's no delivery service. We can't go anywhere to get food. What are you talking about? We feed them." But it's Jesus, so you kind of got to do what he says. So they go scurry around to everybody, and they're like, "Okay, what do you got? What do you got? What do you got?" They come back to the Jesus, and they're like, "Listen, Jesus, we have 5 loaves and 2 fish. I mean, we've been around, we've collected everything that everybody has, and all we got is 5 loaves and 2 fish. That's it. We don't have anything else. It's all I got, Jesus. I know it's not much, but it's all I got." And Jesus says, "That's enough. Your 5 loaves and 2 fish, that's enough. I can work with your 5 loaves and 2 fish. And he takes the loaves and he gives thanks to God and he breaks the loaves. And then he turns to the disciples and says, "What you got is enough. Hand it out." Now I can imagine the disciples at this point in time also going, "Okay, we're going to hand out 5 loaves and 2 fish. There's a couple thousand people here. That'll work. Yeah. But it's Jesus. We got to do what he says." So they start handing it out. And Jesus being Jesus says, "Not only am I going to feed the 5,000, but by the way, there's 12 baskets of leftovers in case anybody's still hungry." The disciples gathered what they had. They didn't think it was enough. They didn't think what they had is very much. They came to Jesus and they said, "We got 5 loaves and 2 fish. And Jesus said, "It's enough. You and I, individually and collectively, come to Jesus and we say, "Everything you have given is what I have. Sometimes I don't feel like it's very much, but it's yours." And Jesus says, "It's enough. I can work with that." So what is this whole stewardship thing going to look like for us? There will be a Sunday on October 20th where you'll get a pledge card to pledge money and time and talents and gifts. It's how we do things. But I don't want you to see stewardship as that alone. I want you to see stewardship as how we live our lives. I want you to see stewardship as bigger than just some sort of pledge that we give to the church, because stewardship is about who God is, how God is at work in this world. And even when we don't think that what we have is very much, when all we feel like is all we got is 5 loaves and 2 fish, Jesus tells us that's enough. Because you see, if all we think stewardship is about time and money, then we begin to think that what we're giving out of guilt and obligation. "Well, I feel guilty. You know, that preacher got up there and started talking about what we need. Maybe I should do a little better this year." Or, "You know, I've always filled out a pledge card. I guess I got to fill one out again this year. That's just what we do." But if we begin to see everything as a gift from God, how God works in our lives, what God can do with our 5 loaves and 2 fish, then you and I begin to see things differently. And we become motivated by grace and gratitude. And we give out of abundance rather than scarcity. If our 5 loaves and 2 fish is enough, individually and together, then it's enough for what God has in store for this church. Because you see, this church is not these walls. The church is the people sitting in the pews at 11 o'clock, at 9 o'clock, the people who can't be here today. The church is you, is us. And the church belongs to God. Everything that we have is His. We're not necessarily born stewards. I mean, that's not necessarily what the world tells us to be. The world doesn't automatically say, hey, you should see everything as a gift from God and be willing to give it back. The world tells us, hey, earn what you get, keep what you get, because it's about you. When God says it's about more, let us begin to see stewardship as a gift from God. The next 3 weeks, we'll talk about what Wesley says about give all you can, save all you can, earn all you can. But may we begin to think about what a stewardship look like. The next week or two, you'll get pledge cards. I'll write a nice letter that kind of tells you what we're planning to do, the things we want to do. But I want you to begin to think of stewardship as more than those, but about how we live life together. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our closing hymn this morning is hymn number 664, Sent Forth by God's Blessing. Let us stand and sing together. Receive the benediction. Let us go forth from this place to be the stewards that God has called us to be, to live in the grace that God has given us. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up His countenance upon you and give you peace, both now and forevermore. Amen.